Redditors that worked with a dating company, Tinder, Bumble, Hinge, etc. What's the most insane user stat or behind the scenes fact you found out about? A dude with over 2,000 right swipes and no matches. A couple met on the dating app I worked on. Unfortunately, the man passed away and the lady returned to the app where they met for remembrance. One day, a bug in the system made some profile likes to be sent again after months and she received one from her deceased boyfriend. Her bug report was heartbreaking. Most dating sites and apps are owned by one company, the Match Group. They have a near monopoly. I think Bumble is one of the few not owned by them. I used to moderate OkCupid. The amount of unsolicited D pictures men would send women, not even accompanied by any words, was horrifying. I mean, you'd expect it because online dating is a cesspit, but the sheer amount would still surprise you. I had to look at each reported picture and say, yes, that's a D. This was years ago now, but I used to work with a guy who had been an engineer for Match.com. He said 99% of the profiles were inactive, and that 80% of the active profiles were men. He didn't provide numbers but also said there was a huge disparity between the average number of messages sent to women versus those sent to men. According to him, all told, the site was mostly men reaching out to dead profiles and never getting responses. As I said, however, this was years ago, so it's entirely possible that they've cleaned the site up since then. I worked for Match for a couple years. This is probably widely known, but women frequently lie about their age and weight and men lie about their height and salary. Also, it's a big problem that women are inundated with DMs while most men get none. Lots of gay guys get banned from Grindr selling weed. Would get a lot of emails of why am I banned. Go to their profile and will say HMU for that's it. I have a friend who works for, I wanna say Tinder, anyway. The company isn't important. What is important is that her entire job is to remove inappropriate images. Her job is to look at D-pics all day. 5 days a week. That's all. No stat. Just a weird ducking job. Not been working, but a friend wrote her master thesis about the different criteria in online dating and real life. Almost half. 43%. The female participants who were in a relationship told they'd never have swiped right on their current partner. Other interesting results were that over 60% of men they wrote with on apps and agreed to go on a date would have no chance if they asked in real life. Edit: since many asked about the thesis, I'll ask her if she can share it here, but be prepared. It's in German. As to the second point, I don't know exactly how she worded the question in the survey, but I think she was referring to clubs and the like. I used to work at Bumble, although this was about 4-5 years ago. Globally, about 90% of the users are men. So there is a huge male to female disparity, although it's not that bad on a per country basis. For some countries, the most depressing stat though was the histogram of word count in messages. Something like 91% of opening messages were just one word hey, and 85% of conversations were just one exchange long. Hey, more than no reply ever. Looking at human digital mating habits splayed out in data science form was really depressing. Update: yikes, this thread really exploded. Some people have asked me a lot of the same questions, so I'm providing answers here. 1. When I worked there, we were not allowed to read the content of chats, only gather metadata about them, word count, number of exchanges. But we could not build models which analyze the content of chats. This chat was about food. This one was about holidays. This one was sexual. This was due to stringent GDPR draft rules to privacy rules at the time. And Bumble took user privacy very seriously. So chats were never read or analyzed for content. Not even by automated models. However, this was 4-5 years ago. And they may have amended their tests since then to allow it. Or they might be analyzing content for non-GDPR countries, USA. Therefore, as others have pointed out, we don't know for sure that the word used most often was actually hey. Could have been hello or howdy. In the office, we always assumed it was hey due to our own experiences on the app. But we did know with certainty that 91% of first messages used only a single word. So we guessed it was hey. 2. The countries which had better male-female ratios, which I can remember, were the Nordic ones. Sweden and Norway were close to 50/50, and for a time, one of them even had more women on the app than men. Not sure how it is now. 3. The GDPR rules were released in 2016. Even earlier draft rules for some industries such as banking, finance and telecoms, but were not actually enforced until 2018. This grace period of 2 years was so that firms could implement all of the massive legal and technical protocols for GDPR. And many compliance tech departments in London did nothing but a mad dash sprint for 2-3 years straight to get GDPR compliant before the 2018 deadline. As such, Bumble was already GDPR compliant, at least in terms of user chats. Don't know about other aspects, well before 2018. As I said, they took user privacy seriously. Even before GDPR, we weren't allowed to read chat messages due to a combination of user privacy tools specific to Bumble and GDPR draft rules. I just wrote GDPR as a catch-all term for all of the various privacy rules in effect then, including tools. But yes, I agree. The rules were not enforced yet. I apologize that I wasn't specific. I wrote my reply quickly this morning not thinking it would explode like this, and so just blurted out GDPR without getting pedantic about which rules in which years. Apologies for any confusion. 4. All these numbers are pulled from my memory of what I saw 4-5 years ago, and thus are not canon law or academic paper worthy. Update 2. Thank you most kindly for all of the awards, kind strangers. I very much appreciate it. We used to create fake accounts and chat with users. It was everything from someone having a premium account that wasn't getting responses to bored employees. My ex-BF worked for the Yahoo Italy dating site back in the early-ish 2000s. His job was to pretend to be a woman and message male customers just as their accounts were going to expire. This would encourage them to pay to renew their subscriptions. Once they renewed, he would ghost them. He only lasted for a few months due to how unethical it was. This is probably going to get buried. I used to work for Shagco UK as a content creator, and by that I mean it was me who replied to messages from users. I used to get paid between 11p and 18p per message, with bonuses for hitting certain message amounts. It was mostly horny guys who just wanted to chat and get off. But I met some interesting people. One, a 60s guy whose wife had died a few weeks prior, hadn't had sex in years, needed a release, spoke at length of how he had picked me because I looked like his dead wife in her prime. To a guy who was in his 80s who was an ex-porn star, sent multiple links to his videos and such. We spoke at length regarding his trips to Africa and all the charity work he'd done. 3. A lot of obvious pedophiles, rapists etc. It was pretty scary what people would admit to with enough pushing. 4. A lot of guys who would agree to whatever weird fetish I dreamed up on that day. Horny people be horny. It all came to an end for me when a guy told me his dad had died that morning, and he wouldn't be around for a while. I got reviewed for my reply, which was, "I'm really sorry for your loss. If you need to talk, I'll be here for you." They suggested that I should have replied, "Do you not care about me? I have needs to." Just realize that the site owners really just didn't give a rip at all. Edit. This blew up a lot more than I could have ever expected it to. Thank you for those of you who left that sweet sweet Reddit gold and other awards. Who would have thought my most upvoted comment on Reddit was about this? Crazy. Should put a serious tag on this. I'm genuinely curious about the answers. Guys swipe right on 47% of profiles. Women only swipe right on 12%. I knew some guys would swipe right more than women. Wasn't prepared for how little women swipe right. Edit. Here's some more. Searching for serious or casual relationships for men versus women. 61% of men want something serious while 38% want something casual. 87% of women want something serious while only 13% want something casual. It's worth noting on that last one that it's partially because of a difference in how men and women would describe themselves if they're not sure. Women would rather say something serious if they're not sure to see how something goes, but happy for it to turn casual if they're not feeling it. While men would prefer to say something casual and then happy for it to turn serious if they like them. This is why we've given an and added a not sure option in our big update next week. Feedback on chats users. We're unique in that we only let you chat to 3 users at a time. So you have to end a chat to talk to someone new. When you end a chat, you have to give private feedback. Here's some of the feedback people choose. You can pick more than one. 34% ghosted, didn't say anything. 12% great chat. 11% polite and respectful. 11% not enough in common. 8% no chemistry. 8% hard to talk to. 2% rude, inappropriate. Why people ghost? We call ourselves the anti-ghosting app because we notify you if someone replaces your chat with someone new, since you can only talk to 3 at a time. Doesn't stop rejection, but at least you're not left wondering and waiting. We did some research with users to find out why people ghost on dating apps. They could choose more than one answer. 43% avoid the awkwardness of saying I wasn't interested. 37% they said did something I didn't like. 36% was too busy and then it was too late. 32% couldn't be bothered to keep replying. 28% I forgot to reply. 25% couldn't think of a reply. 23% too many other people to respond to. 22% I've never ghosted anyone. 6% other. Source: I'm the founder of a dating app. Edit 2. Thanks for all the awards, support and kind words. Seriously means a lot. Have tried to answer as many questions as I can and might even do a proper AMA when we launch our big update next week if there's interest. I'd really be interested in what someone working at Ashley Madison or Gleeden has to say. I would love to know how openly cynical the algorithm really is. My feed on Hinge shows absolutely no one I am interested in. And suddenly, the roses feature pops up. I am interested in all the people in the roses section. But, oh, it's you, a cute fort to buy one rose. Which is no guarantee of a match, much less a date. They want to keep you using the app and spending money for as long as possible, and their slogan "designed to be deleted" is such BS it's comical. And you can't turn to other apps because they're all owned by the same corporation. The reason I found my partner, we have a child together, etc., is because she handed her phone to a friend who accidentally swiped up while taking the phone and super liked me. My old boss was the financial controller of a big dating site. He kept on seeing these big invoices for modeling agencies and initially thought it was because of the big parties they used to host. When he asked about it, it turned out it was just content for the fake profiles they created to lure in users. Okay, so I didn't work with a dating company per se, but I helped software engineers optimize their profiles. Men get very few matches, regardless of how good their profile is. Women get a lot of matches, but most of those matches are useless. Edit: this has gotten a lot of attention, so I wanted to share my basic advice. 1. Don't try to appeal mildly to everyone. Appeal strongly to a small subset of people. Emphasize who you are. 2. Show, don't tell. What makes a person want to date you? Will you impress them with your volunteer work? Will you bring them fun places? Will you make them laugh? 3. Get good photos. If you have 2, get a friend with a good camera to take photos of you multiple times over a day with several changes of clothes. 4. Be brutally honest. Do you need to go to the dentist because your teeth are gray? Go. Do you need to get a haircut? Go somewhere that charges $50 a haircut and tell them to do what they want. If male, do your clothes fit? Ask a fashionable friend. Remember, people are judging you on your appearance as much as you are judging them. They can't see you're kind of funny or interesting. They can see if you're well-groomed and making an effort. Any more advice and I charge $50 an hour. Approximately 9,000% of women from the Pacific Northwest love adventure. I forget the source, but I remember hearing one of the sites come out with data that suggested that women were way more picky than men. Men would typically be attracted to about half the women they saw, whereas women were only attracted to about 10% of men. There was also some stuff on certain sexes and ethnicities getting more attention, but I don't want to get too much into that one. Just Google if you are curious. OkCupid has a blog where they share some cool insights. I worked with Bumble for about a year, and the most insane user stat is that Redditors are always horny and will stick anything up their butts. My takeaway from this: I'm screwed. Between the pandemic, my lack of social skills, and a burning shyness and introversion, I'm going to be a 40-year-old virgin. Edit. Wow. Was not expecting to come back to this. I appreciate all the kind words and tips. I've been working on improving myself along with my social skills, but it's been difficult with everything going on. You all take care of yourselves. I ran operations for an online dating company, notably not affiliated with Match. From database analytics, I can tell you a few things. Men initiate contact around 80% of the time in straight matchmaking. And if you are a woman looking to date other women and you simply initiate contact with another woman, you have a good chance of success, simply because it's very common for women to match but then neither initiates contact. I think we were able to determine that it takes on average about 3 dates before 6 happens. I don't recall how we worked that out. I'm not a data analyst. But presumably it was some keyword based algorithm looking at chat messages. We got so many requests for information from the police that we had an informal system with them. To save them from wasting time getting warrants for information about people who we didn't have data on. They would ask about a particular name, email, whatever other identifier, and we would just say yes we have data about them or no we don't. And if we did, they'd then go get the warrant to get a copy of it. The other thing I can tell you from our analytics, that really shouldn't be at all surprising, is to get some decent profile photos. Go get your talented friend or just hire a photographer to take some really nicely lit, well-composed photos of yourself and watch your match rate soar. There was a post about 1-2 months ago on subreddit, Dating Advice, which explained the best way to use Tinder to your benefits. It was something like, don't like everybody, also don't like girls who put their Instagram in profiles, because most of the time they won't respond to you and they just won't follow. Instead, focus on girls who have nice bio, and over time 1-3 weeks algorithm is gonna learn you and it's gonna match you with potential candidate. At first you might have 1-2 matches, but over time you gonna get more and more. Most of the people give up after 4 days. There isn't enough time for algorithm to learn you. Since this got attention, I tried to find thread. Here it is. Thread. How many perky The Office fans are out there? I never worked at Occupied, but years ago I reported a few profiles and then they made me a mod. There were more fake or scam profiles than D-pics. We think some profiles were reported just because someone didn't like how they acted. But once you start image searching, you would typically find that those profiles are fake or belong to real people that are definitely not on a dating site. There were a bunch of accurate and proven catfish reports, and a lot of cute pets. Pictures have to be of you, not your dog, and we would comment for the other mod's cute dog but breaks rules. Also Google the image of the dog and sometimes find out that it's someone else's dog. Managed and worked on a short-term personal security detail for one of the C-listers of one of these in LA. Not mentioning by name BC, I'm not trying to get doxxed, but there is a huge problem with people getting stealth WHIV and other venereal diseases. As well as being mugged or robbed while ducking about on these apps, and the victims will threaten to lash out at the company violently or even show up at the offices demanding to speak to someone in charge while in the initial anger stage, despite the company having no personal hand in the situation beyond arranging the medium for which to meet. Apparently the company can't even send out a warning about the suspected user who is accused of stealthing to level public health due to counsel advising that it's slander with anything less than bona fide evidence of that person being positive for the disease, committing a crime against the other, and or that person meeting the other and or having intercourse. The companies do cooperate with law enforcement on a case-by-case basis, but they do have the right to clam up and wait for a subpoena before they share user info, chat logs, etc. Meanwhile, there are multiple people who have been robbed of thousands of dollars, given a disease, and many more victims waiting to be had while the company sits on its ass and lets the complaints pile up. Even then, it's a whole messy area where it's cheaper to not even get involved. Even banning the user from the service involves some amount of steps. I don't blame the victims for being livid, but what a whole ass ducking mess. Got a few still images of the people we were keeping an eye out for, and they looked like completely normal guys and girls who just got pushed to their breaking point. All BC, they trusted someone from a dating app. Couldn't happen to anyone, honestly. I tried to sign up for Match years ago, but they denied me because nobody in the system matched me. You wanna sit find anyone from these companies that will reveal anything crazy, but what people should know is that dating sites apps are legit 80% men. So unless you're devilishly handsome or have something else to compensate for a lack of looks, you're just not gonna get anywhere. Imagine there's 100 people on a dating app, 80 men and 20 women. In reality, maybe 5-7 of those women are worth pursuing. Because obviously not every woman is attractive. You are competing with 79 other dudes for 5-7 women. Your chances are slim to none, assuming you're even average. So long story short, you're 1000x better off flirting and getting numbers IRL as opposed to being another card in the deck on some mediocre app. Never worked for one, but had the misfortune of finding out a behind the scenes thing that really pissed me off and could have ended my relationship. If you've previously used Tinder, please read this. It could save your ass if you're in an abusive relationship. I was on Tinder a few years ago and met my then partner at the time on it. We hit it off and started dating officially. I'd heard that uninstalling the app wouldn't delete your account, so I made sure to be overkill when wiping my profile. I deleted all my photos and bio, then made it private, then deleted my account, then uninstalled the app. 7 months later, my partner's friend came across my Tinder profile. According to him, the photo was my public Facebook profile pic and there was nothing written for the bio. I had never reactivated my profile. I had zero knowledge of this. I tried to figure out what the duck was happening and discovered Tinder had automatically grabbed my Facebook info and used it to recreate my account and make it public. Thank duck, my Facebook profile photo was a very lovey-dovey couple's pic of the two of us, so that was what Tinder used. My partner knew me well and that I detested cheaters, so he trusted me fully. He also knew I wasn't stupid enough to use a couple's photo of us as my only Tinder pic, and that I would never have an empty bio. I also never put my job info on my Facebook, so thankfully Tinder had left that blank. So when my then partner tipped me off about this ducked up thing Tinder had done, I was proper horrified, because it turned out all my work clients and friends and whoever else that had been on Tinder must have come across that profile and assumed I was some shameless cheater. I wanted to make sure it wasn't a fake profile someone else was controlling, so I redownloaded Tinder in front of my partner and logged in, to discover I was logging into the exact almost empty profile his friend had described. It turns out Tinder does that to anyone who forgot to restrict third-party app access on Facebook. At the time, that was a very buried Facebook setting you needed to be on desktop to deactivate. I went online and tried to post in a few places to warn people. I'm really big on online privacy, but I just got called a cheater who was trying to cover her tracks. No one believed me at all. I just got heaps of it for it, even though my partner was 100% on my side and I just wanted to try and help. I ended up deleting those posts because nobody believed me and I deeply regret that. Can you imagine if someone in an abusive relationship had that happen to them? I should have left the posts up so they could have googled and found it. My partner, we broke up years later but we remain friends, was a good man and he knew me inside out and that I would never cheat nor do it in such a ridiculous and counterproductive way. But if I'd been trapped in a relationship with someone controlling and abusive, no ducking way would they have ever believed this story, because let's be honest, it sounds pretty far-fetched. Tinder automatically creating an account and making it public without ever warning the user. No one would believe them. This all took place back in 2015 and at the time I found two other forum posts discussing other people's trouble with it happening to them, so I'm not sure if it's been changed in the last 5 years or not, but still. Restrict third-party access in your Facebook settings. People. Edit. I'm really ducking over the messages I've been getting from incels accusing me of lying or making up fake information about Tinder deactivating any profile that isn't active for a week. First, that's complete bullshit, because I've had times where I hadn't logged in for over a month but everything was still the same. Second, I have no reason to lie about something this old using such a crazy sounding tale. Third, there's plenty of other Redditors responding with their own stories of it happening to them. Duck off and stop being so nasty over someone who is just trying to help others and spread the word of yet another app that is violating your privacy without many people knowing. A guy once called me 85 times in one night because I went to bed instead of calling him and he likes to teach itches lessons. Edit. I'll be honest. I misread the question and just thought people were sharing random stats based on their online dating experience, lol. My bad. Grabs popcorn. I hope this gets answers. Edit. Anyone have dirt on the app Mutual? Asking for a friend ass. One day I got a message from OkCupid's official account. Hi, it said, we've been watching you. We like what we see. You have charm and treat people how they like to be treated. Here is a great member of OkCupid. We like to offer you the position of being a moderator on site. This perk comes with a premium account for free. What do you need to do? Keep being yourself. Except now, as a global moderator, you will be able to keep the site clean. So it's great to learn they mean they had been monitoring my conversations up that point. After I accepted, I found out this was not a paid position. Instead, I could, wait for it, moderator powers, turn invisible, turn member invisible, change compatibility score, read or write messages on any member, mod notes, see any information about the member, including contact info, search messages for text, read deleted messages, edit anything on the user page and account, see all photos, including deleted ones, ban, shadow ban user, apply the membership level, add a note, which other moderators only see, send a warning to the account, see user stats about interaction on site, see and edit user's likability rating, change user profile options, including answers to quizzes, see not published quizzes and the details on how each quiz would rate, create a quiz, this one didn't work, close bracket, see if you are on other match services, and your interaction stats on opening message rates. Report profile to admin and open a filter that auto-banned people from their messages. Use the whistle icon to flag a profile for more severe reasons. Open edit and send us messages from a user account. Could also compose messages as the user in case you missed that one. Moderating photos opened a mini-game thing where mods could vote yes or no for nudity. Enough votes made it auto-ban account. I had a button next to that said, force vote or something. I had some admin buttons for some reason on that and other pages. For a moment, I would like you to imagine invisible drama caused by site moderators of a dating site who can it will cause the apples of their eye to get perfect messages from matches with 100% compatibility suddenly. You see, I wasn't the only moderator. Match had sent a similar message to hundreds of other users. And now all these free moderators had the keys to conversation and contact data. It was an absolute train wreck. I think I'm one of the only moderators who didn't abuse power. For example, mods could see last online time and use multiple paid items without any charge. Yeah, OkCupid was saying, in return for keeping the site clean, have power over all user messages, email and phone number, send warnings, go nuts nah, what's that, you like dogs. Me too. Also, your golden retriever named Maxine, age 4, is adorable. He must love running while you listen to your favorite artist Nina before returning to around 173 Court Drive and walking into the house with a door your grandfather carved while you log into OkCupid at 3:47. The third time you logged in of the day, you have 40 unread messages, but don't worry, mine's at the top. Boy, that was a cute photo you deleted. What's that? You read the message but didn't reply? Who's this Theodore you are speaking to? Haha banned. Look, we are 100% compatible. Let's talk. I'm the only message in your inbox now. Yeah. Moderators were absolutely insane. And OkCupid did a fantastic job checking for qualified moderators. Clap and a half. Real nice work. Ah. Also, there wasn't a single female moderator in the whole dang site from what I could see. Oh. And yes, you most certainly could click moderators and read their data. I think the first thing each mod did was delete the mod notes on their profiles. I specifically remember one moderator who would add photos of the person who last messaged to creep the girl out so his message would get a reply. Others would delete all her messages and send power-ups, then make their message rise to the top of the user's inbox and crank compatibility scores. Power-ups never actually do anything, by the way, or change men's profiles. So they never got a match and left derogatory messages on their profile. The owner of the profile will never have a clue their profile now contains private notes. Close bracket. Or straight up ban someone who had the girl's interest. Or make him a smoker with 8 kids and the opposite she wanted. The funny thing is I could ban and demod moderators. I'm going to guess not everyone had that cause there wouldn't be as many mods. Some of the prettier girls would have multiple moderators fighting to send a message to her. More than once, they wished they could ban that moderator. A phrase that got them dethroned. if I saw it other times. Photo mod chats would sometimes show a particularly horrible mod. I'd strip them of their power. I still don't know to this day if I was supposed to do that or not. Lol. There was no contact from the site administrator. No collaboration. Guidelines. NDA. Nothing. Just a creepy message, we've been watching you. And poof. A badge visible to you and other mods and the ability to wreck hearts. No clue what their mod criteria were. No chat for the mods aside from profile notes and messages in the photo moderation tool, which did nothing but carousel an endless parade of nude photos. Think I'm full of it? You are welcome to your own opinion, but take note that thatsnotacupid.com was closed and feel free to read another mod's Imgur post. Mods would even make leaks. Pick one profile to use as a chat forum. Or set people's profiles to receive no interaction for their pleasure. Thus, some would take over profiles sending messages as the guy talking to a girl ever spoke with someone who was meshing well with you. Then all of a sudden, they belted out an incoherent, unsettling message. It might have been a jealous moderator who wanted the person gone. All the private quizzes your answer? We could see the results. A profile states, I'm Amy, and I'm a Christian. Except almost none of the messages would be Christian, as every answer about 6 was set to yes. This is not info someone first saying hello to Amy should be able to see. But this was the reality. Amy might have her beliefs and wants, but I believe she and every other girl should be able to reveal them if and when she wants to, not have them in a readable format for her top message of the day. And worse, you could see if someone was ghosting you because moderator power let you click on their private life. There wasn't even a confirmation prompt. I demoted mods and edited spelling errors in profiles and kicked bad users. Also sent warnings to users by sending them a message from themselves to their inbox. I would always end those with time machine deactivated just to mess with them. From, you maybe I should try something else. This girl might not want a D picture. Perhaps she's a dog person? Maybe I should stop pasting the same message. After all, it's only gotten one response. Time machine deactivated. One person I specifically remember got stood up multiple times. He was chatting with a girl real time and she was interested. He was interested but had the confidence of a gnat. I made a judgment decision. Sent from his account as him, hi, would you like me to call you? If so, what's your number? We've been chatting for a while and was wondering if you wanted to go out soon. Deleted that message from his sent box. Then sent him a message that timely said time machine activated from himself. The girl was ecstatic and replied with a number. 2 weeks later they both deleted their accounts. And the girl had chosen the option met someone new. The last action I took as a mod was search users for staff admins and anyone who worked at a Cupid. Then I sent the only copy paste message I ever would, tearing into the mod abuse. Their neglect of the site. Their half-assed veto selection. The massive overreach we had over users. The weird cliques on profiles. A list of moderators who deserved to be removed or banned. And the stupidity of not having a place for moderators to discuss topics and get advice from site admins. I signed off with a bug report and account deletion. I nuked my account one day because I just wanted it to date, not vote on D-pics and demo D's. I got a second invite on my other account but deleted it. The second message specifically said, come back as a moderator. So I think a person, not a bot. Send those messages. Final secret, your info is sold. All of it. Every click you make is used to make you look more desirable for money while lowering the pool of users around you. And every site interaction is logged down to how long you stay on a profile. To this day, I don't trust any text version of a platform. I encrypted Evernote notes before they offered the option to, before the decision to let employees read your notes, and downright refused to hold a conversation on any dating platform. Quickly moving things to an in-person date. Or at least, well, I used to, because you never know what power-hungry, horny, unchecked moderators are sniping about how your butt looks in black jeans. My conversation usually goes, hi, unique thought about your profile, personality, or thought-provoking question. I'm, name, would you like to talk on the phone? No? And you have a wonderful life. The creator of Match.com got cheated on. She left him for a man she met on Match.com.